The title of this talk is Democratizing Creation, a 3D printer for living things. So many of you guys know about the MakerBot or the Formlabs printer for making plastic, non-living 3D objects. That's cool. Everyone can use a computer, design a 3D plastic object, print it out, test it, see if it works, right? And it's affordable enough that pretty much anyone can buy one of these machines. But what if we could actually afford to make living creatures by using a computer to design it, printing out the sequence that codes for the organism, and then test it to see what it does? That would be an interesting, exciting world if everyone here today could write code for living organisms. The issue is it's too expensive. So here's kind of the larger idea is that we can print living things. It's kind of an important problem. I mean, we were just outside. It was really beautiful. We saw lots of nature and living things. It's all run by code. Even the meal that we had before was code. We were eating software. Software is eating the world, but we're eating software, right, Mark? There we go. So the air we breathe right now was produced a long time ago by living things. The things that you're, you know, these are leather. Andres probably doesn't like it, but, you know, those are from animals. And then lots of consumer products come from biology as well, plastics as well as oils, which are used to make many things. And they're all produced biologically. So it's kind of a big thing. You guys are a living, so I think many of you are important. So in computers, we store the ones and zeros, the software code, in a computer, in memory, in transistors, right? With living things, we store the DNA code in A, T, G, and C, and we run that in the computer of a cell. Now, it's crazy, but at one point in time, each transistor, it costs like a dollar each. And when it costs a dollar each, that means when you type the character on a keyboard, when you were, you know, if you're trying to program, it would cost $8. So people, you know, at the early days, couldn't really afford to program. Then it became cheap, it became democratized, they started making these transistors massively parallel in a fab. And then everybody started programming computers, and a couple of guys with laptops could start a company that could maybe, you know, be worth more than $1 billion, maybe Google. So where are we at now? Well, we're at punch card level right now. But what's crazy is that sequencing became a million times cheaper within the last 7 or 8 years. Wow, that's crazy, right? I mean, it was about a dollar a letter, and now $1 buys you about 3 million letters. That's good. But we got this issue here, because today $1 buys you 1A, 1G, 1T, 1C, and so, you know, Sean, you know, what you're working on, it's expensive, right? So what if it was $1 buys you 1,000 letters? What could you do then? What if it was a million times cheaper? What if $1 bought you 1 million letters? Well, it would unleash a whole new range of applications, which I'm really excited about. So right now, a protein costs you $500. A plasmid costs $5,000. That's a, you know, that's a few proteins or a few genes. Bacterial genome, 1.5 million. A yeast, 4 million. A human is, you know, a couple billion. It's kind of a little too expensive. If we drop, you know, the price by 1,000-fold, that's 50 cents for a protein, $5 for a plasmid. Bacteria costs 1,500. Yeast, 4,200. Human is about, you know, instead of billion, it's million. You know, three more orders of magnitude, it's a 20th of a cent for a protein. A plasmid, you know, is half a cent. Bacterial genome is $1.50, a yeast genome, $4. And then human genome, you know, is at the $1,000 level that we see with the $1,000 genome for human sequencing. So that's exciting. And what that unleashes is a build cycle like we see with things that are fab today affordably. Design it on a computer, design your protein or the thing that you want to make, print it out, and test it. And because it's biology, it's hard. You have to iterate many, many times. And you have to actually, since computers aren't powerful enough to predict the solution, you know, on the first go, you actually need to be able to make, you know, 50,000 different possibilities. Today, you can use software, it'll give you those 50,000 possibilities. But the issue is that you can't press print. There's no printer button. And so last year was great. We heard from Adrian, we heard from Omri, Genome Compiler, talking about these amazing computational tools for designing DNA. And we're even seeing these competitions where people are predicting the folding of proteins. And eventually, people use the same software backbone, Rosetta, to do design and do design at scale. But you need to be able to press print, because a computer says one of these 50,000 ways is the solution, and it costs you more than a car to print out two or three of them, well, you're not gonna find the solution. So let me give you an example. Say, for instance, you want to make a protein that binds selectively to a cancer cell. You use a computer program, and you know it gives you 50,000 possibilities for a shape that you want, the shape of a protein that will bind selectively to a cancer cell. Right, but you actually have to make them all. But you know, if you actually can print all 50,000 solutions, then you know one of those things will be the one that works. Let me give you another example: Martian microbes. So if we ever want to leave Earth, we're going to need an ability to bring living things with us and make living things that do good things for us, that make life outside of this wonderful biosphere possible. So a company below us is actually working on an interesting thing where they're making synthetic microbes that can take Martian soil that has a molecule called perchlorate, release the oxygen from that molecule and create from soil. And that's going to be really necessary if we're going to go to space. We're going to have to make all kinds of things, the fuels, air, food. The way this works is you make a synthetic genome, you replace it, the native genome, with the synthetic genome. And then the cell actually boots up as the software code that's located in the DNA defines. And then we get these nice little glass domes and people happy inside. Brain-computer interface. So Sergey's got the glasses on now. What if it goes in your brain, right? That's interesting. What if we could actually have a really great brain-computer interface where we can use light to not only turn on our neurons and create thoughts, but also be able to read out what we're thinking. Currently, it's open loop. We can only turn on neurons. We don't have the ability to see what electrical activity is doing because we don't have a means of turning electrical activity back into light. So that's something when you can engineer biology easily, where you can press print many times, it becomes a possibility. So this is called optogenetics. You're using light to turn on neurons. Eventually, what we want to do is be able to not only turn them on, but also optically observe their firing. Resurrection. So I'm not talking about Jesus here. I'm talking about bringing back extinct animals from the dead. So woolly mammoths, things that you see in museums. We have their DNA code. It's all broken up in little pieces, so we have to actually read it, write it, synthesize it, and then transplant it. And then implant that cell into a similar organism. So in the case of a woolly mammoth, implant that synthetic DNA in a cell and put that new cell into an elephant or something similar. In this case, I don't think there's many things like elephants. So how does this work? Well, how does the technology work? Well, when you're making hot dogs, you're making clothes, you're making transistors, you get a certain yield, right? Part of the batch that you make is good. Part of it is bad. You have to have a selection process to select the good ones and throw away the bad ones. This is pretty much universal across pretty much all of manufacturing. So since about 1994, we've been able to make DNA on microarrays massively parallel, being able to make millions of strands at a time. It's kind of a known science. But what we haven't been able to do is, one, we have to separate all those things out. Right? So it's all a bunch of, it's a million different things, and many of them are full of errors. How do we deal with this problem? Well, we attach the DNA sequences to beads. We attach one strand of DNA to a bead. Okay, everybody there? It comes off the microarray. We attach one piece of DNA to a bead. We copy it about 100,000 times on the bead. Okay? That allows us to separate all the different strands out from each other. And then we copy it many times on that bead, copies of the same molecule. Okay? Then what we do is we take those beads and we stick them to a glass surface. We then optically sequence these things using not electrical probes like when you test out transistors, but four color probes, color A, color T, color G, color C, and we actually read out the code. And we use this for quality control, right? So we can see the sequence, they're all in these beads. And for every one of those, we have a bead ID, we have an XY coordinate position, and we have a readout of the sequence with a certain quality score. We pick the ones with the high quality score that are the sequence that we want. Then what do? Well, we laser print them. After we know the correct sequences, we use a laser to recover the DNA. This is called laser pulse catapulting, or laser induced forward transfer, or laser tissue microdissection. It's an old method for recovering biological samples. Most people have used it to collect cells. We're using it to collect clonal DNA on beads. So, write a million. That's a lot of DNA. That's about 100 million base pairs if each one's 100 letters. You read a billion strands or a billion different beads, and then you you pick the correct ones. And using a laser light, you can do this very quickly because you can move the light instead of actually having to move around the DNA. And if any of you know about, you know, laser light shows or being in a club where the laser's moving around fast, it's basically two mirrors. And you know, people use an engraving already to write up to, you know, 1,000 different spots in a second. So it's a high throughput way of recovering the DNA. So here's what it looks like. Here's a picture. This is one picture out of many that's on a flow cell. And each of those yellow spots is a unique bead, a unique sequence. So I'm going to show you a zoomed in version of that. So each one of those beads, one of those yellow things, has an XY positional coordinate and a sequence. All right, we're only picking the correct ones, the ones that don't have mistakes. So this is actually what it looks like. This is a kind of a Blair Witch Project type of video, but it's the first time we did it, so I'm sentimental about it. Here we're laser printing jellyfish DNA, 100 base pair constructs, from the glass surface of the sequencer onto a collector plate. And I looped this video a few times, but this is 100 base pair jellyfish DNA on a bead. You see the laser light flash, the bead ejects into the collector plate, just showed one more time, but it's a pretty straightforward process. So what we've done is we've created a print button for biology, and what this is going to do is going to make a lot of the living world around you synthetic and better and improved, and there's many, many applications. We can kind of go on for the, you know, about the applications for a long time, but we can expect improvements in medicine, improvements in our health, and personalized medicine that is personal to you. And I think that's very exciting. We'll also be able to print many new creatures that make our planet even more interesting, and the creatures that will need to eventually leave this planet. So thank you.